Tofalava, Bulavanaka, Kia ora te whanau, Aotearoa Hauranga, o Aotearoa Alianza. It's my very great pleasure to introduce to you all Paul Stacey. If you do a quick Google search of Paul, you're not going to find much because it's hidden quite deeply, but there's a lot more to him than the Creative Commons and Open work that Lianza's 2017 Open Program Committee chose him for. Paul lives in Vancouver in Canada. He's been a high school teacher teaching autistic children. He's worked on the revision of Canada's national curriculum for air traffic controllers. He's made his own kayak. He's been a researcher, and he was my mentor last year in Cape Town when I was part of Creative Commons Headquarters Institute of Open Leadership. Paul's got a stunning presentation for us all, so please welcome him to Lianza 2017.
Tēnā, tātou, kātou, kor Paul Stacey, aho. It's really a delight to be here from Canada. I've never been to New Zealand before. It's been awesome so far. And I've really been enjoying the conference. I think that the sessions have been really high quality, very diverse set of issues that you all as librarians are exploring. And I really think we should applaud the organizing committee for this conference, which is doing a stellar job. As Paula mentioned, I've been working for Creative Commons for the last 5 years. I worked for Creative Commons headquarters supporting the adoption and use of Creative Commons around the world in all kinds of sectors, by government, by educators, by librarians, by museums. And over the course of that work, I became convinced of the importance of openness, which is your theme for this conference, as a critical new way for society to operate. But one of the things that I found was, even though I worked for Creative Commons and all my colleagues were comfortable talking about copyright and intellectual property and all of the things that are associated with those kinds of issues, very few of my colleagues would actually talk about the commons. And so I became a real advocate for talking about the commons within Creative Commons, and I decided for this talk today, I wouldn't so much focus on licensing according to how Creative Commons works, but instead talk about this notion of the commons and the future of the commons, which I feel is really a critical idea, not only for libraries, but for our countries and nations around the world. So maybe first of all, I should contextualize this. So what do I mean by the commons? And here I'm going to draw on the work of Eleanor Ostrom on the left, who won the Nobel Prize for Economics for her work on the commons, and also from David Bollier, who in my view is a real contemporary person that I admire and look for leadership around the commons. And so really a commons is a community-based social system, usually independent of the market and state, and I acknowledge that as librarians you're really heavily dependent on the state. But I would also suggest that you are, in a sense, a form of commons. But the idea of it is it's community-based, it's a social system, and it's really involved with the stewardship of resources over the long term. So when I look at the theme for this conference, open, what I see as that theme is a kind of verb, it's an action, it's a thing that you do to make things available for others to see, to use, to reuse, to mix. But when you make something open, where does that thing go? It goes into a commons, a shared pool, a collective shared pool of resources that all of the members of the commons have a responsibility to manage. At Creative Commons, one of the things that we've been doing for the last few years is publishing a State of the Commons report. This looks at what is the growth of the use of Creative Commons around the world and how many resources from different parts of the world are being put into the commons by Creative Commoners, if you will, using the Creative Commons licenses. And so last year, 2016, 1.2 billion works have been licensed using Creative Commons and are out there in the commons. That's a really a large number given that Creative Commons itself was just formed in 2002. So you're sort of seeing the kind of exponential, what we in Canada would call the hockey stick growth of the adoption of Creative Commons, and it's still continuing to grow dramatically. I wanted to highlight for you just some of the examples that are in last year's State of the Commons report. So these show the diversity of use of Creative Commons across different sectors. So here we can see that Europeana, which is a kind of aggregate portal for museums across Europe, museums and libraries across Europe has 27.7 million Creative Commons licensed works, and the specific example of the Hamburg Museum of Art and Design having published 7,000 public domain works that they have in their collection related to photos of Japan. So museums and libraries are one sector making heavy use of Creative Commons, but then we also have open access. So one of the verb uses of open in the academic research field is open access, and what we see is a really growing use of open access journals for the publishing and release of research articles that faculty are doing. So the Public Library of Science has 160,000 Creative Commons licensed research articles in its collection. And there's a diverse number of open access journals that something like the Directory of Open Access Journals can point you to should you like to find an open access journal in a particular field. In North America, in the education space, there's been a huge adoption and use of what are called open education resources. This is the creation of curricula for K-12 and at the tertiary level to support faculty and students in having access to high quality, freely accessible resources. And one of the areas that's received a huge amount of attention over the last couple of years relates to textbooks. Because as you probably all know, all of you that have kids going to university or college, the cost of a textbook for some courses can be quite high and has gone ratcheting up higher and higher every year. So there's been a significant effort, especially for the year 1 and 2 level courses at college and university, the high enrollment courses, to create an alternative, high quality, awesome textbook that could be used instead of a very expensive commercial published book. And so this is an example of OpenStax, their physics textbook, which was co-authored by some of the most esteemed physics professors across North America, and has produced a book that can be adopted by faculty and students studying physics at any university around the world. And one of the things that one of my colleagues in Poland has been involved with is translating these English physics and biology and calculus books into Polish, because they're openly licensed with Creative Commons that allows them to be not only used in North America, but used anywhere. And the cost for the student is zero. Unless they want a print copy, and then essentially they're just paying the cost of printing. So open textbooks, an education example. Lots of creators, and this is really going back to the origins of Creative Commons, so photographers in this example using 500px as a platform that they upload their photos to and share them using Creative Commons licenses. So a lot of platforms like 500px or Flickr, which was really popular and continues to be really popular, the platforms are baking in the option for a creator to put a Creative Commons license work on their work in the process of uploading it to the platform. And the placement of a Creative Commons license on the work then also makes it searchable and findable over the web and findable by users who are using that platform who want to find open content like photos. 500px actually focuses on kind of high quality photos from professional photographers. In addition to photos, we have videos. And so a platform like Vimeo has 5.8 million Creative Commons licensed videos. So when you think about your patrons, the public or the students or the people who are coming into the library looking to find videos, to find photos, you could point them to copyrighted works, but as you know, the use of those works requires the permission of the creator that created them. Or you could point them to openly licensed alternatives that can be freely used without having to seek permission from the creator. And so if you go to Vimeo, for example, you can just search for Creative Commons licensed videos by topic, by subject, and potentially find something that would be really relevant and useful to one of your patrons. And one of the other things that, of course, happens with openness is that you get a high number of views. So because it's open and easily accessible, there's no barriers. You can quickly access it and look at it without having a paywall between you and accessing that resource. Here in New Zealand, there's been some great examples of openness, open data related to the earthquakes and other natural disasters in GeoNet, where all the data is openly licensed using Creative Commons and has provided a service for citizens around hazards related to these disasters. And I also want to highlight the work of CC New Zealand, which has been involved with publishing this fantastic book The Quiet Revolution, which highlights some of the awesome work that has been done in New Zealand around openness, including really great case studies. And Mandy Henk is right here from CC New Zealand. So if you'd like to talk about the use of Creative Commons in the New Zealand context and also how you might get more involved or make use of it, please talk to Mandy. I also want to highlight that in the early days of Creative Commons, it was all about individual creators, like photographers, musicians, filmmakers, adopting Creative Commons and putting their work out in a way that allowed it to be shared. But increasingly, what we're seeing is that it's morphed from individual creators using Creative Commons to organizations, to big time use by government for open access research, for open data. In New Zealand, you've got the NZ Goal, which is really making a lot of data that government produces available, among other things. Open GLAM, so the whole gallery, library, archives, and museums sector, education, and open science. These would be the big sectoral or discrete areas in which Creative Commons is being used very widely across the world. I don't actually want to go into all of those, though, although you may, if you came to the workshop on Saturday, we started to actually dig into each of these areas and sort of explore what's out there right now. How do you find it? How do you make use of it? What are the benefits of it? Instead, I want to talk about all of those things as a kind of commons. And when I provided a definition for the commons at the beginning as a social system that is community managed, one of the things I want to talk about is that social system. What is the social system associated with managing resources that are being put into the commons? Because this is actually an area that we have underpaid attention to, and I think is really important. So one of the ways that the social system works is that it has a set of rules. And the rules in openness are different than the rules for copyright. So copyright has a sort of closed set of rules. As a creator, I've created a work, it's my work. You can't use it unless you ask me permission or you pay me or whatever you want to make as the terms for someone else to use it. Whereas on the open side, you have a whole set of permissions that are expressed up front. Don't have to ask for permission. The creator is saying, here's this work, I'm freely sharing it with you, you can copy it, and depending upon which of the licenses they choose, and you can see the licenses including the public domain mark across the right-hand side there, they may or may not be giving permission for it to be used for commercial purposes or allow it to be changed, but a whole set of permissions are openly expressed up front that invite you to make use of the resource, to copy it, to distribute it, and potentially to revise it and use it for a whole wide variety of reasons. But my point is that the permissions and kind of rules, let me say, make it rules here, are really defined in a different way when we're talking about openness. And I also would suggest that the permissions are different. So a traditional library, you borrow a book, that physical book has a set of permissions associated with it that require you to return it after a period of time, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, whatever it is. But with open resources, the permissions are different. And here I've shown what are called the 5 R's associated with open education resources. And you can immediately see that if you're making use of an open education resource, you get to retain it forever. You don't have to return it. It permanently becomes yours. You get to control it. It's not time-bombed by some publisher and disappears after you've taken that course. You get to actually keep it for as long as you need it. And the other R's, you know, you get to use it, to revise it, to remix it, to redistribute it. These are all permissions associated with open education resources. And in the Creative Commons context, we're talking about a commons that is primarily digital. And so I think for the most part, libraries have been very focused on being physical commons, a place where books and other resources are housed and curated, where the public and others are invited to come in to access. But of course, as we've moved into high tech and the internet and the use of Creative Commons especially has really focused on digital works, and a digital commons operates in a different way than a physical commons. And I just wanted to highlight this because I think this is a really important concept to think about when we're talking about a commons. So if we're talking about physical goods, then you know they are rivalrous. You can exclude people from having access to those works. They are depletable. They can be depleted completely to extermination, as we sometimes see with forests and fish. Or if we're talking about physical books and things like that, there's a replication cost. But when we talk about digital things, they're essentially inherently non-rivalrous. if I have one and I give it to you, now we both have a copy. It sort of works that way. And so you can make it non-excludable. It is by its very nature non-excludable. It doesn't deplete. And because of the way technology has scaled up over time, the actual cost to replicate a digital thing is really close to $0. Now I want to point this out because as I move forward, one of the things I want to explore with you is the economics side of all this. Yesterday and at several other sessions, I've been hearing all the talk about the declining budgets that libraries have and how do we make the case for more money. And I think that part of the challenge there is making that case in a way that has a compelling rationale and fits inside a larger framework that can be put forward to those who are providing funding. And one of the ways that I think we need to think about doing that is to leverage the unique affordances of digital things. And so when we're talking about digital things, you know, processing speed, bandwidth, storage, essentially doubling every year, but the costs are not going up, they're going down. So the way the economics works on the digital side is very different than the way it works on the physical side. And I think that we need to really try to show how we can take advantage of this in terms of leveraging services that really are not necessarily very expensive. Another way that a digital commons is significantly different is in its potential. So if we're talking about digital things, they could be infinitely abundant. But I would suggest that today, what we see happening is they're made scarce. I'll call it artificial scarcity because there's no reason for it to be scarce other than the need to kind of recover some money from people by charging them for it. But potentially, inherently, it could be infinitely abundant. So there's a different kind of potential associated with a digital commons than is part of what a physical commons is. And I will also suggest, and for me this is the most exciting part of the whole thing, and is in my view the most important part of the whole thing, which is that there's a potential here for a different way of participation. A way that invites people to get engaged in the actual commons itself in a very unique way. So let me give you some examples. Wikimedia every year runs Wiki Loves Monuments. And so they essentially invite people from around the world to take photos of significant heritage sites and monuments in their part of the world, share them back so that those photos can be used in Wikipedia articles and enrich the description of the culture and history of those particular countries. And by doing that, they invite and get 11,000 users from 42 countries to actually contribute photographs. So this is a different kind of practice, right? This isn't Wikimedia hiring hundreds of photographers and sending them around the world to get those photos. This is them appealing directly to citizens and engaging them in participating in co-creating a highly valuable public resource on behalf of everybody. And that kind of idea, I think, has a lot of potential for libraries. Here's another example. This is actually a similar data portal in El Salvador, although it's much more diverse than the earthquake and natural disaster hazard example here in New Zealand. The El Salvador one was actually generated completely by citizens, and it covers everything. It basically is citizens aggregating open data from their government and housing it in a portal that encourages entrepreneurial use. You also have this hugely growing field of 3D printing and platforms like Thingiverse, which are acting as a hosting site for designs related to 3D objects that are Creative Commons licensed those designs and invite other users to modify those designs and use them for different purposes than were originally intended. So you get this kind of skull being remixed into a candy jar. And then the person who did that remix makes that new derivative design available on the same platform. From a librarian perspective, I do think the Chicago Newberry Library is onto something interesting. They've got several ancient books, particularly books dealing with magic, that are written in Latin. And they're inviting the public, anyone who understands Latin, to assist with the translation of those works into English so that they become more generally available. But this is just another example of opening works and inviting the public to participate. You have the New York Library of Medicine taking diagrams that are part of the kind of inherent way in which medicine is taught and putting those diagrams out, taking advantage of the coloring book craze that has kind of swept the adult world and inviting people to take those diagrams and color them and submit them back to the library where they can be put back out in colorized form. And then my favorite is the Rijksmuseum in the Netherlands, which is a really incredible museum. And they were one of the first museums to take the bold step of Creative Commons licensing their collection. So they digitized hundreds of thousands of the paintings in their collection. They created high quality, high res versions of those digital images, and they Creative Commons licensed them, put them up on their website, and made them freely available for people to use. And then they took a rather bold step, from my point of view, by creating what they call the Rijks Studio. The Rijks Studio is a special platform. I actually have a studio on the Rijks Studio, so anyone can go to the Rijks Studio and create your own studio space. And when you have your own studio space on Rijks Studio, you can take any of the hundreds of thousands of digitized images of their collection, download them into your little studio, and then you can kind of take snippets of them, you can mix them with other works, and once a year they run the Rijks Studio Award, which invites the public to use the Rijks Studio to select images that they would like to, in the bottom left-hand corner, print on a kimono. So the beautiful swan on the back of the kimono is an actual part of a significant painting from the Rijksmuseum. And the images actually on the front of the kimono are from different paintings in the Rijks Studio. And that kimono is for sale. You can buy that. Same with, the other two images are from this year's Rijks Studio Awards. So one person took the Delft tiles, the blue tiles that are famous in the Netherlands, and made contact lenses out of them. So you can have contact lenses that make your eyes look like a blue tile. Or made sleeping masks out of images of people's eyes from famous paintings. And whoever wins the award, what happens is the Rijks Studio commits to help them produce their work, and they actually sell it in their Rijks Museum's store. But all of the works that get created by people using the Rijks Studio can be completely commercialized and sold. And so what I think is rather bold of the Rijks Museum is the encouragement of entrepreneurial use of their collection. It is not seen as just preserving cultural heritage. It's seen as a source material to stimulate new creative works that not only are for creative fun and pleasure, but also can be seen as drivers of the economy, contributors to the economy. If I go back to the major sectors like open education resources, open access, open data, open government, and so on, when I look at those, initiatives around the world, one of the things that strikes me is that really, as those initiatives mature around the world, they increasingly engage and involve librarians. Librarians are integral parts of the teams that are creating open education resources at most universities that I've ever worked at. Librarians are key people for researchers who are looking to put their research outputs into open access journals. Librarians are acting as key open data people in terms of taking the metadata associated with their collections and openly licensing it and making it available through an API for others to do things with it. So there's a whole set of openness practices that also invite a different kind of participation, not just from patrons and the public, but a different kind of participation from librarians themselves. And I would suggest that there's also obviously some needs there associated with the pedagogical learning of how to be a librarian that have to do with becoming expert and skilled at all things related to openness. But when I think about a library, and you probably think this way too, and many of the sessions that I have attended at this conference are really thinking about a library as a physical commons, right? We have the traditional view of the library as a place that you go to access written works and borrow them for periods of time. We also, though, I find this really fascinating, the growing physical commons of a library beyond just books. So at my library in Vancouver, You can borrow a musical instrument. I can borrow a trumpet or a trombone or a violin. And we also, of course, are seeing toy libraries, tool libraries. We're seeing kitchen utensil libraries. We're seeing in the US a tie lending library for people who are looking for a job and don't want to buy a tie. They just want to borrow one for the day. So what we're seeing is like a diversification of a library's function to other physical goods, which I think is awesome, although I do find it curious in some ways that most of these things are not being done by libraries, but by other organizations who start these things up from scratch. They seem to me like fairly natural extensions of what a library already does fantastically well. So I encourage you to do that. And then, of course, libraries in an academic context increasingly are creating learning commons for students to study, to access resources, and also typically include access to technology and support for them. And I would say that one of the things that I look at when I go to institutions now that have a learning commons in a library, I ask the librarians, so do you help the students find open resources? Do you teach them about Creative Commons? Do you help the faculty not plagiarize everything with their teaching materials? Anyways, I think it's a really important concept. I do like some of the stuff that's happening with libraries around diversifying the physical space of a library to be about other things than just the library. So this example in the Netherlands has a cafeteria, a cafe associated with it, where you can go and get coffee and tea and something to eat. And it also has a chocolate factory. So why does the library just have to be about books and a physical place that is for people to go and find those kinds of things? Why can't it be about a broader range of things than just that? And then lastly, I do think it's interesting to see libraries getting involved in makerspaces and 3D printing and the like. And the one on the right actually is another example from the library in Vancouver. It's called the Inspiration Lab. And so in Vancouver, you can borrow a musical instrument, and you can also book a recording studio and go and use that recording studio to record the music that you're creating or to record an audiobook that you want to create. And they have an associated set of a kind of technical equipment that lets you edit and save that kind of recording. But I think of these as hybrid spaces. They're mostly a physical commons, but they have a digital element. And so, these are all kind of new potential things that libraries could be doing. But then I know from speaking to many of you, it's like, well, we're already like overwhelmed with just the basic things we're expected to do. Our budgets have been cut. We're sort of been skinnied down to the fewest number of people. How are we ever going to take on these new initiatives, especially in the context of budget cuts? And so I'm going to shift now to talk about that aspect of openness and the unique kind of things that are happening related to the commons. And I'm going to put forward to you a kind of economic and social rationale that I hope you can begin to bake into the proposals and requests for funding that you're making to the funders. It's going to take us in a very different direction. This builds on work that I've been very interested in. So I've been involved in Creative Commons use ever since 2003. And the number one question I always get is, why would I ever do that? Why would I give away my work for free? I could sell it and get rich. It may be kind of completely an imaginary scenario, but that's kind of a typical question that, even if it's not explicitly asked, is in the back of people's minds. And so a colleague and I decided to, and Creative Commons as an organization, interestingly, has never tried to answer that question. There's never been a direct answer to that question. So I thought, wouldn't it be fun if we actually had a direct answer to that question that could satisfy people who have that in the back of their mind? And so a colleague and I undertook to write a book, which just got published in May. It's called Made with Creative Commons. And it essentially looks at that question. Why and how might it make sense to openly license resources, make them available under a Creative Commons license for free reuse and remix, distribution, copying, and how would you ever, at the same time, still generate enough revenue to sustain your operations? So there's the URL. If you want to go there, of course, you can get a Creative Commons licensed version of that book available for free download. as a PDF, an ebook, an EPUB, whatever you like. So here's my colleague Sarah Pearson. Together we wrote this book. The way we raised money to write this book became an example of how to do what we were studying, in a sense. We raised money on Kickstarter. We ran a Kickstarter campaign and invited people to fund us to write this book. And we raised over $60,000 from 1,687 backers in a very short period of time, kept having to extend the goals and commitments that we made. So it was very exciting. It's actually a real challenge to do a Kickstarter campaign. So I'm happy to talk to you about that. But here's what we committed to do. We said, we'll interview 24 examples from around the world, from across all sectors, of organizations and creators and businesses that are already doing this. They're already openly licensing things, core resources and assets that they have. They're putting them out into the world, making them available for free. And they're still successfully running and operating as an organization or business. We'll interview them. We'll talk to the founders. We'll get their story. We'll write their story up. We'll share what their strategy is, particularly their strategy around revenue generation from a sustainability point of view. And then once we finish the interviews, we'll do some analysis at a kind of higher level across all 24 of them and look for trends and themes and put those out as suggestions for others to follow should you want to do something similar. And then finally, we said we'd do a significant lit review, and we would also kind of situate this in a kind of meta framework, a big picture framework that is more at a societal level. Well, we were really ambitious. And the whole idea was that it was intended to provide some guidance and support for others who are trying to make the case or are trying to lead their organization in this direction. The process of picking the 24 was really quite interesting. Like if you were to say, who are the top 24 Creative Commons using organizations around the world that we should profile, what we ended up doing was we invited our over 1,600 Kickstarter backers to nominate businesses and organizations they wanted us to profile. And then we put the invitation out to the Creative Commons community as well. And we were literally flooded with like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of suggestions, from which we created a short list. And then we put the short list out to our Kickstarter backers for voting. They got to vote. And through their votes, we picked 12. And then Sarah and I reserved the right to pick the other 12. We had to have something that we could control. And here are the 24. I won't say, I mean, you probably recognize some of them or many of them. I won't describe all of them because it would take too much time. But just to quickly highlight maybe some of the ones across the top, just to give you a sense of the diversity of the kinds of usage that we're seeing. So Arduino is a electronic circuit board maker. They make electronic circuit boards that the design of the boards are openly licensed using a Creative Commons license. The boards have open source software on them. The boards are used primarily for teaching purposes by faculty at institutions where there's a heavy emphasis on art and design and music. And they provide the students with an ability to do electrical things in a really simple way. But they've been around for years and are a highly successful manufacturer of electronic boards. Blender makes 3D animation software and actually produces 3D movies that are Creative Commons licensed. Cards Against Humanity, some of you may know that, that's a really offensive party game. But we use them as a case study. They're a really interesting case study because they're so outrageous. Cory Doctorow is a famous writer. He's actually Canadian but living in LA. He writes kind of science fiction books. But he publishes his books under a Creative Commons license and at the same time sells them. Figshare is a platform for researchers to publish their data and research to. Figure.nz, some of you may know that. It's in Auckland. They're kind of taking public government data and creating visual images of that data, which they make available off their website. Knowledge Unlatched, anyone doing work with Knowledge Unlatched? Okay, so Knowledge Unlatched is actually focused on working with librarians and publishers to enable libraries to get the kind of maximum bang for their buck, essentially. So what they do is they invite publishers to make books available to Knowledge Unlatched that libraries want. First, they actually survey the libraries to see what books they want. And then they work with publishers to say, will you make the book available in the following way, which is the Knowledge Unlatched works with librarians to gather enough money to pay the publisher the cost that it took them to actually get that book to the point where it's going to be publicly released. So they can recover completely, in one fell swoop, their upfront costs through the Knowledge Unlatched initiative. And in exchange, what they have to do is agree to openly license that book with a Creative Commons license and put up a digital version of it for free that anyone can access and download. And so it becomes essentially universally accessible to all libraries around the world for free. That's a simplified version of their business model, but you read the book and it goes into detail. I'll skip the rest, but it's like there's museums, there's music platforms, there's musicians, that's enough. You get a sense of it. And we called this work Open Business Models. That's how we framed it initially. And that ended up causing all kinds of issues. So what do we mean by a business model? I say business model, you think whatever you think. And so no one had a kind of consensus of what a business model is. So we ended up adopting the Business Model Generation Handbook. I actually went and took the training that they offer on being a master person using it. And they have this thing which they call the Business Model Canvas, which provides a common framework for understanding what a business model is and talking about it. And we definitely started out our project using the Business Model Canvas, although they published the Business Model Canvas with a Creative Commons license, which allowed us to remix it because the business model generation folks were primarily focused on the for-profit sector, and we also wanted to include the public sector and the nonprofit sector. And the Business Model Generation Handbook didn't talk at all about Creative Commons licenses. It's very much focused on proprietary IP. So we remixed it to add in use of Creative Commons licenses and other things. Anyways, here's some of the key things that I'll say emerged out of this work. All these case studies, it became evident that they're not your normal business. They're not your typical business in that they weren't just in it to maximize profit. That's not why they were there. They weren't just trying to restrict access to the things, the products and services they have until you pay them money. They, in fact, were making it completely openly available for free, at least some of what they do. They weren't about, in the kind of traditional market sense, monetization of commodities. And they weren't about sort of extraction and consumption and selling to the highest bidder. It wasn't just about the bottom line. So in a sense, if you're using Creative Commons and going open with the things that you're doing, you're kind of business unusual. That's how I began to describe it. Another common trait is that they were all driven by social good. So all of the 24 examples, if you talk to them about what are you doing, why are you doing it, look at their mission statement or their vision statement, it all had to do with making the world a better place in some significant way. And so business unusual in terms of sharing and openness, driven by some sort of social mission. And then finally, the way they viewed their customers, their users, the people that they were making things available to, was also significantly different from the way a typical business views a customer. They viewed the customer as someone who they wanted to establish a human connection with, a relationship with. It wasn't just an anonymous sale to someone who they couldn't care less about except them purchasing something from them. Instead, what they wanted is some sort of personal connection with the people who were interested in using the thing that they are producing. They wanted to collaborate with them, not just have them use the thing, but also invite them to shape it, to change it, to make suggestions on how it could be developed in a different way, to suggest product improvements, almost like outsourcing your R&D to your public users. And I know I'm talking about this in a business context, but I need you to think about this from a library context. And they also wanted to build a community around it. So they're very much interested in how do we take the things that we have, put them out in a way that connects with people in a really valuable way, and how do we collaborate with those people and build a community around it to sustain it going forward over time. So in a sense, because I usually get asked, like, just tell me what I do to make money in this open business model context. You know, they wanted a really simple one-line sort of response. So here's my one-line response. Have some Creative Commons licensed resources that are really high value. The higher the value of the resource, the greater potential engagement you'll have from the people wanting to use them. If you're just putting out some trivial resource that nobody really cares about, your level of engagement is going to be low. So you need to put out Creative Commons license things that have high value. That's the first thing of my formula on the left there, CC. Make sure that the intent behind why you're sharing those things has some sort of social purpose to it. You're trying to make the world better. You're trying to make people's lives better. You're trying to help things get improved in a social justice, social good way, because that also creates willingness on behalf of the users to engage with you, to engage with those resources. If it's just about you getting rich, people won't engage. What's their motivation? How is it going to help them? So if you have a social purpose, they will engage and they will help. And then look at them not just as a consumer, as a buyer, as some anonymous person with money that you're trying to extract, but as someone with whom you want to have a relationship, that you want to build a community with and have a human connection with. And if you do those three things, then there's potential for you to have additional things that you do to generate money. And across the bottom, I've listed some of the ways that the 24 case studies we examined generate revenue in addition to doing those three things. And some of those ways are kind of traditional market-based ways of generating revenue, and some of them are more sort of what we called reciprocity-based, where it's not necessarily how a business typically generates money. I want to also highlight this. This is not in the book, but is something that I've been starting to study ever since writing the book, which often happens. And that is openness changes the business operational procedures associated with how a business works. And so here on this slide, I'm just sort of showing how a business typically operates. You know, you have R&D, you got some manufacturing or assembly or product service creation, then you have sales, marketing, business development, and then after that, you're going to distribute and deliver your goods to your customers, and you're going to provide maintenance and customer support. That's the traditional model for how businesses operate. But I want to show you one example from the case studies and highlight for you how they did it differently. Because I think this is really important. I think if you're doing open and you're just slapping open on top of how you typically are running your organization and business without thinking about how openness changes your kind of core procedures, you won't be successful and you won't be sustainable. You need to rethink the whole way your organization operates. So here's one example. This is an example called Open Desk. Open Desk manufactures furniture, wooden furniture, the kind of furniture you might put in your office. What I've done across the top is show how they do R&D or how they do each of the stages of the business operations. So they don't design the furniture themselves. They invite furniture designers from around the world to send them designs. And they sort of outsource, if you will, the R&D function of a typical business to people distributed around the world. And then they handpick which pieces they might want to include in the Open Desk collection and curate from across the global designers things that they want to have as part of their offering. And then once they've selected designs that will be included in their furniture offering, they don't actually make it themselves. What they do is they find CNC manufacturers, these computer numerical digitized saw places, so a maker essentially, and there's makers all around the world who do this. And if you're trying to buy a piece of furniture from Open Desk, they'll pair you to a maker that's in your region, close to where you live. And that maker will make the furniture for you. Open Desk has no factory. Nor do they have to store the furniture in some sort of warehouse before shipping it to you. The maker just makes it on demand based on request. So they don't have to do distribution and delivery, really. And in terms of the warranty and customer support, it's a shared responsibility between Open Desk and the maker. So they've sort of outsourced R&D. They have no factory. Sales is actually done through matchmaking you to a maker. There's no warehouse, and maintenance and customer service is a partnership. And the way they describe their model and contrast it to the traditional way in which furniture is made is that they say it's greener, less costly, more sustainable. You're not manufacturing stuff and not knowing whether it'll ever sell. And it also enables personalized manufacturing, which is kind of interesting because the designs that they have for the furniture are all Creative Commons licensed. And so let's say I would need a chair, but I need a chair that's bigger than that chair. I can actually go in and modify the design for that chair, create a slightly bigger chair, and the maker can make me that slightly bigger chair. So you don't have to buy a sort of mass manufactured all common size chair. You can customize the chair. And then the other thing that they like to talk about is how the people who buy OpenDesk furniture love the story about the furniture. You know, it's not like who made this chair? The chair you're sitting in, you have no idea. No idea. It's completely anonymous to you. But the people who buy OpenDesk furniture, what they love is they know who the designer is. Oh, this chair was designed by so-and-so who's from Indonesia. They know who made it. It's made by the maker around the corner. I got it at so-and-so, and they cut it out for me and assembled it for me. And so the furniture has this kind of provenance, this story, this kind of this history that is fun to tell and morphs the furniture from being some sort of anonymous all-purpose good to having some impact and meaning that goes beyond a typical way of considering furniture. So I wanted to show this just as one example. I could have done that for all 24, but how they rethink the way that a traditional, you know, how we traditionally manufacture furniture is not how OpenDesk is manufacturing furniture. And when we think about moving into openness and creating resources that are going into a commons, we need to rethink that kind of procedural view. Okay, going to move up now to the meta view, the big picture view at a kind of societal level. You're going to have to go with me on this one. This is a bit of a leap of faith because I know that some of what I'm talking about is like completely off the radar screen and no one's talking about it. I'm trying to reintroduce it. So I'm going to say that historically there have been three ways by which we create and manage resources. Those three ways are the market, the state, and the commons. So if we think about the commons, we might say that was in play a long time ago, especially in the European context. If we go back to Britain, let's say, you know, you had all these people living out rurally on the commons, shared land, shared water, shared forests, managed by the community of people living on the commons collectively. There was a market, but the market was largely run by the people in the commons. And the state was largely the monarchy. And then you had the appropriation and enclosure of the commons by the state. So the whole story of Robin Hood is really how, you know, the king kind of took all that commons land and excluded the commoners from it and took it over themselves. It's kind of a story we've heard frequently. And the market started to grow. And one of the things that happened was the state took the things that used to be in the commons and gave them to the market to be used for industrial purposes. And the people who used to live on the land were forced to move to the city and became workers in the market. That's kind of what happened, right? And so what's, you know, this picture is trying to show now, this is like contemporary times where really, you know, when I look at your recent election and the party that got the largest number of votes, they believe in this model. This model says the market is the best way to create and manage resources. We're going to privatize stuff. We're going to reduce the role of government and the state and the commons. Like, what the heck is that? It's not even part of the discussion. Yep. That's good. Thank you. So if I look at the 24 case studies we did, one of the things I started to think about is, are they commons-based organizations? And someone like Wikimedia, I would suggest, is a completely commons-based organization. No involvement really of the state or the market in the work that they do. Even their revenue generation is entirely done through donations by individual users. But if I look at a company or an example like Arduino, I would call them a hybrid. There's a part of the way that their business operates that is embracing and operating as if it's a commons, operating under principles that are like the commons. But there's another part of their business that very much operates like a market, traditional market business. And so part of the success of these initiatives is understanding which part of your business is a commons-based part and how does that need to work, and which part is a market-based part and how does that work. If you try to operate the commons-based part of your organization as if it's part of the market, You just piss everybody off, and no one will engage with you. And someone like the Rijksmuseum, and this might be also similar to most libraries, is primarily a state initiative. But in the Rijksmuseum's case, because they basically have digitized and made openly available with Creative Commons their entire collection, they have a significant footprint and engagement with the commons. And they still charge things like admissions to come into the museum, so they also have a component where they're generating revenue through traditional market means. So part of what I've been saying to organizations is, wrap your head around, if you're going to go open and begin implementing open, you need to think about the open part in the context of the commons and try to operate it the way a commons operates and understand what parts of your organization are part of which piece of those three entities. And the key thing is to realize that the market and the state and the commons operate differently. And one thing that I did was took some of Eleanor Ostrom's awesome work and simplified it into these four quadrants. So the characteristics of a resource, the people and processes involved in creating and managing the resource, what are the norms and rules that govern how that's done, and what are the goals or outcomes that are being sought. And I'm going to simplify this down really simple and say, here's roughly what it looks like. Each is color-coded, so red is the market, blue is the state, the green is common. So in terms of the characteristics of the resource, you know, the market's creating private goods, the state's creating public goods, the commons creating commons goods. One of the key differentiators is on the people and processes side. So in the market, you know, we've got businesses that essentially are acting as intermediaries between the creator or producer of a resource and the person buying it. It's kind of roughly anonymous and an indirect representation, whereas when it comes to the, and same with the state, right? So with the state, we elect people into government who are supposed to be acting on our behalf. I use the word supposed to be deliberately there. But with the commons, it's very direct. Anyone can choose to put something into the commons and choose to actively engage in the commons themselves. They don't need permission from anybody. And you can see that in the norms and rules that the market basically is operating based on property law. The government gets to make policy, regulation, and law. And Creative Commons itself, and the licenses we produce and the permissions associated with them, they operate as a kind of norm and rule for how the commons can be socially managed by a collective community. And very much different on the far bottom right are the purpose or the goals or outcomes that each of these three entities are trying to achieve. So for the market, it's about maximizing profit, it's about growth. For the state, it's kind of quality of life and looking at the economic and social well-being of citizens. But for the commons, it's more about how do we engage universal access and participation in the creation and use of these resources? How do we ensure that they're equitably distributed across everyone? And how do we generate economic efficiency through that process? And what are the benefits, balancing the benefits to individuals with those of the community? One of the things, so I'm just going to quickly go through a few last things and stop. We definitely uncovered what I'll call a set of commons principles. So when you speak to the organizations that are doing this kind of work and ask them, you know, how do you operate? What are the kind of things that you keep in mind? They basically talk about these kinds of things. Make sure you add value. Make sure you give more than you take. If you're making use of resources in the commons, be very transparent about what you're using, how you're using it, how you're improving that, what you're monetizing and what you're not monetizing. Be sure to give some attribution and gratitude to the people who are putting things into the commons that you're using. Develop trust, defend the commons. And we see a lot of that expressed in various declarations, like the Cape Town Declaration for Open Education or the Budapest Declaration for Open Access Research. And then if I was putting forward to a funder a rationale for why I wanted to receive funding to do this kind of work, I would be highlighting these kind of benefits. These kind of benefits cannot be achieved by the market. These are benefits that can only be achieved by the commons. And so I think that you can put forward a very unique argument for access, for equity, for efficiency, for flexibility, for participation, for lower cost, reach and impact, personalization, greater ROI, that is very unique to openness and the way a commons works. And I would not be trying to put forward a rationale that is grounded in the way the market works, because you won't be successful. If you judge all this by market rules, doesn't necessarily make sense. If you judge it by these kind of rules, it makes huge sense and can be very compelling. So really with the commons, we're sort of seeing or advocating for a shift from scarcity to abundance, from exclusion to inclusion, from impersonal to personal, and so on. You get the sense of how they're different. And I think that we need to amplify this kind of story and message with the things that we're saying to the people who are using our services and the people funding them. I also want to quickly lastly highlight that I'm not the only one now starting to talk like this. If you want to point people to sort of economists that are talking like this, Kate Raworth's book, Donut Economics, is really fantastic. She's talking about how 21st century economics needs to be different than the way we've thought about economics historically. And she very much has created a model that considers how we need to be thinking about the purpose of economics and the economy as being something that benefits citizens in a significant way. And we need to think about our economies in ways that are managing the use of the resources that we're taking advantage of in a way that is sustainable. This also is part of her model, and you'll see in the center that she sees the economy as having four parts: the market, the state, the commons, and the household, she calls it. And I'm actually thrilled to see, especially in the European context, the emergence of a whole suite of commons-based initiatives related to food, related to the city as a commons. There's a European Commons Assembly. There's the Commons Network that's writing policy for government and elected officials. And there's big initiatives like the Commons Transition Group that is looking at the entrepreneurial and use of the commons. So what I'm hoping is that we can move from this, where the market is dominating everything and all decisions and all management processes, and the commons is essentially almost completely invisible, back to something that looks like this, where it's a more balanced — I'm not saying we need to get rid of the state or the market, we just need a more balanced way of doing things that includes the state, includes the market, and includes the commons. And I think, for me, libraries have this really important, significant role to play here, and I hope that it's something that you can begin to embrace and take advantage of.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. Now we've got a couple of minutes for questions. Has anybody got a question that they want to put their hand up, and we'll get a mic to you? No, that's phones. Mandy Hink. Absolutely. We've got a mic running down to you right now.
So one of the things that I hear when I do these workshops is people talk about something called the tragedy of the commons. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times it can be challenging to help people understand why that's a fallacy. Is that something that you could speak to?
Sure. So the tragedy of the commons is a very famous essay written by Garrett Hardin. But it turns out that he didn't actually study the commons in any way. And he basically wrote what essentially is a piece of fiction about how he imagined a commons would work. And when Ellen and Ostrom went out and actually visited commons and talked to people about how a commons works, it turns out that in a real commons, people talk to each other. And Garrett Hardin's Tragedy of the Commons essay assumed that people would not talk to each other. They would just compete as heavily as they possibly could and take as much for themselves as possible without ever speaking to each other. But in the real world, in the real commons, people speak to each other, and they actually figure out norms and rules that are equitable to everyone and balance the individual's needs against those of the whole community. And so I think you can refute, call it fake news.
Paul, we're going to wind up now. It's 2:39. I'm just going to grab a tweet that from Brendan Moyer, Christchurch City Libraries. Thanks, Brendan. Libraries are driven by social good. CC and libraries are intertwined. Social engagement is important. It's about making connections. I think that sums up your speech beautifully.
Thank you.
Thank you from everybody.